Welcome back to Poemistry Channel. In this video, we are bringing you part 2 of our tutorial on integrating Poemistry inverters with the Home Assistant system. Unlike the first video, where we use a Solar2 MQTT for integration, this time we will show you how to connect and control your device using ESP Home. We will walk you through the entire process from hardware preparation and software setup to firmware flashing and communication integration, helping you achieve smarter interface management in a simpler and more efficient way. Ready to begin? Let's get started. Preparation. Let's start with what you will need. On the hardware side, besides your inverter, make sure you have a development board that supports ESP Home. In this video, we are using the ESP32F3 as an example. A TDL2 RS-485 communication module and the necessary wiring. On the software side, you need to have Home Assistant and the ESP Home device builder installed in advance. You will also need to download the relevant package from the link provided in the video description, which directs you to the official Poemistry forum. In this video, we will be using the Poemistry Smart SP5K model for demonstration, so be sure to download the package for the HF series. The package includes two versions of YAML configuration files, a detailed setup guide, and a USB to serial driver. Hardware connection. You can refer to the wiring diagram below for the connection. In this example, we are using an ESP32F3 development board. First, use a wire to connect the 3.3V pin on the ESP32F3 board to the VCC pin on the TTL side of the TTL to RS-485 communication module to supply power to the module. Connect GPIO-16 and GPIO-17 to the modules TXD and RXD pins, respectively, for serial data transmission and reception. Also connect the GND pin on the ESP32F3 to the GND pin on the communication module to establish a common ground. Note that RS-485 side of the communication module also needs to be grounded. If the module does not internally connect the ground lights between the TTL and RS-485 sides, you should manually connect the GND pins on both sides to ensure stable ground for RS-485 communication. Next, use a Cat5B cable to connect the RS-485 interface of the communication module. Connect pin 7 of the cable to the A terminal of the RS-485 interface. Connect pin A to the B terminal. With this wiring method, the communication module is powered by the ESP32F3, providing a simple and centralized power setup. Alternatively, if you prefer to power the module from the inverter side, you can connect pin 1 of the RS-485 cable to the 5V pin of the ESP32F3 board and pin 2 to GND, enabling independent power supply for the module. Adding a device in ESP Home Builder. Open the add-on section and go to the ESP Home Device Builder configuration page. Enable the toggles for Watchdog, Auto Update, and Show in Sidebar. Then launch ESP Home Device Builder. Next, click ESP Home Builder in the sidebar to enter the ESP Home Builder interface. To add a new device, click the New Device button in the lower right corner. Give your device a name. If this is your first time adding a device, you will need to configure the Wi-Fi settings. Just enter your Wi-Fi SSID and password and click Next. Next, select the exact module of your development board to finish the initial setup. You will see an auto-generated encryption key, which will also be available later in the YAML file. For now, just click Skip, since we still need to configure the device's YAML file. Configuring the YAML file, click Edit to open the YAML editor. Here you will see some basic configuration and functions that are automatically generated by the system. Let's briefly go through them to better understand how things work. The name and friendly name fields define how the device is identified. The name is the internal identifier used for communication, while the friendly name is what appears in the Home Assistant interface, making it easier for users to recognize the device. The ESP32 section shows the hardware platform. If you selected ESP8266 in the previous step, you will see ESP8266 instead. The board field lists the exact development board model you've selected. And the framework indicates that Arduino core is being used as the base. Next, the system includes some essential functions. Logging is enabled by default and helps record the ESP home device's behavior. You can set a logging level. Inform is recommended for normal use as it displays generate message, warnings, and arrows. If you are in the development stage and need more details, you can choose debug. Then we have the network and remote access settings. These include API communication with Home Assistant using an encrypted key, OTA updates for firmware upgrades, and Wi-Fi access settings. The Wi-Fi credentials are usually put from the secret YAML file, but if you are just setting things up for personal use, you can directly enter the SSID and password here. There's also an AP mode, which acts as a fallback hotspot in case your main Wi-Fi isn't available. After reviewing the auto-generated content, open the YAML file you prepared earlier and paste its contents into the editor. This file includes the serial connection setup, Modbus protocol configuration, sensor settings, selector configuration, and tag sensors. It enables full monitoring and control of the inverter, offering everything you need for daily use in one package. In the zip file you downloaded, there are two YAML versions, the basic version which we are using now, and an advanced version which contains all the features of the basic one. Plus additional configurations that are commented out, you can enable those features as needed. The package also includes a detailed guide explaining the advanced configuration and helping user understand different components, so you can fine-tune it based on your own needs. Back in the editor, after pasting your prepared code, make sure to replace a few fields. Update the ESP home name and friendly name, the board model, and the API key. Once you've replaced everything, delete system-generated code that's no longer needed, and click Save. Flashing the firmware. Now it's time to flash the firmware. Connect your ESP32 development board to your computer using a USB cable. Click Install. Then select the plugin to the computer running ESP Home Device Builder. If you see a message saying no serial devices found, there are a few things to check. Make sure your ESP32 is properly connected via USB. If you are using a virtual machine, verify that serial port is correctly mapped. And if you are running Home Assistant OS or the supervised version, ensure the device has permission to access the physical serial port. Once your device is detected, select the correct port, and the system will start flashing YAML configuration to the board. When you see success, it means flashing is complete. Click Stop to exit installer. Connecting to the inverter. Next, go to Settings, then Devices and Services, and add the newly detected ESP home device. You can choose to name the device and assign it to a room, or just click Skip and Finish to complete the setup. After being automatically redirected to the ESP home interface, connect the ESP32 development board to the inverter using an RS-485 to TTL module for hardware communication. Once the system detects the device, You will be able to view real-time data and control the device directly from this interface. Adding dashboard cards in Home Assistant. To add a device to your dashboard, click the Add to Dashboard button at the bottom of the data panels. This will pin the device to the overview page, allowing you to monitor it alongside your other smart devices in one place. You can also create a power flow card to visually show the energy flows between the solar array, inverter, the grid, and your battery. We will cover how to set it up in our next video. That's it for this video. We hope this updated integration guide helps you connect your Pomister inverter to Home Assistant more smoothly. If you are run into any issues during the process, feel free to leave a comment or email us. Your questions and feedback help us improve this series. If you like the content, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. Thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video.